So the focus for this year's meeting was the theme of the meeting, which most of you are aware of by now, is on simplification. And so I'm just going to give a bit of an introduction to that at a fairly high level. And then what we're going to be hearing is really simplification and the rationale for simplification and what we mean by simplification through different aspects of hepatitis B and C. Okay, so here are my disclosures. And so what I'm going to start with is just why we need simplification, and then I'll talk a little bit about what we mean by this term, and then really spend most of the time talking about some key considerations for both hepatitis B and C, because although similar, there's some key differences, and particularly when it comes to simplification, there are different challenges. So first, just why do we need this? Well, I think it's important that we sort of keep our eye on the prize of that we're really trying to get to these elimination targets, and most people are familiar with these, but I think, as I'll show you, we're really not on track. These are from earlier this year, where you see that most countries, and I've highlighted where Canada sits there, are not on track to hit these elimination targets by 2030, and one of the big reasons for that is that we're just is that things are too complicated on many different levels, and when we really look at the global level, and these data are probably slightly out of date now, but this is what Andrew Hill put together a couple of years ago estimates of what would happen in 2017, which was probably the biggest year in terms of the total number of people that will ever be treated for hepatitis C globally. Is what they looked at here is that impressively, 1.5 million people were cured in that year. A number of people died, both from hepatitis C and non-hepatitis C-related causes. But despite that, we saw that there was very little impact on the overall prevalence or burden of this disease, because in the same time that there were 1.5 million cures, there were 1.6 million new estimated infections in that year of 2017. So you see that despite this really massive treatment uptake, there's been fairly little progress at the global level. And so when we think about why we need simplification, well, the truth is that despite what I just showed you, that even in the year where we had probably the largest number of people being treated, we didn't really make a huge dent. If you look around, particularly in high-income countries, what's been very clear over the last 2 years is that treatment rates are declining. So despite better access to treatment, higher diagnosis rates, and more people in the field, there are declining treatment rates. We've seen that in Canada, and almost every high-income country has reported the same trend, which is quite concerning. Now, I've heard people say it's, well, because there's no one left. We've cured everyone. Well, unfortunately, that's actually not the case. It's because we've really focused primarily initially on treating people that were already either linked to care or had already received care. And so in some ways, the low-hanging fruit for treating people and finding the other people, the so-called missing millions, requires new approaches. We need to bring new people into the field, and we need to think about new models of care. And a big sort of common theme between these things is that we really need to simplify the way we're doing this to allow us to have these new approaches, new providers, and get to new models of care. I think it's important to think about the pros and cons of simplification, because it is important to remember that this isn't always the best thing for everybody. So if you look at the population level, clearly simplification has major benefits. So more people get diagnosed when you simplify things, more people are treated, more are cured. Overall, the costs go down, and generally there are fewer long-term complications of the disease. So you make public health impact, and it's important to think about this as a public health approach. But it is important to remember that at the individual level, there's possible harm. So when you simplify things, some subtleties may be overlooked or missed, and those can have consequences. And also, there is potentially benefit at the individual level, because obviously as you improve your access to care, some individuals that may not have otherwise been reached may be getting reached. So fortunately, the treatments are so good for both hepatitis C and B that most mistakes can be remedied. So I think it's important, and I think the reason that there has been a push to simplify is that the population benefit greatly outweighs the small possible individual harm. But it is important to remember that there is that small possible individual harm. And I'm just going to illustrate that with one small example. And these are data with glecaprevir-pabrentosfer, one of the pangenotypic regimens. Most of you will be familiar with this as an effective regimen, and you can see that very, very high cure rates across across all of the genotypes. But I just want to highlight one thing that came out in the phase three trials, that if you look at this small group of patients that had this particular resistance-associated substitution, this A30K, you can see that if you look at those that didn't have this resistance substitution, you can see 99% achieved cure, whereas if you had that resistance-associated substitution, you can see that with 8 weeks, the SVR rate dropped to 75%, which most of us would consider to be less than ideal. And if treatment was extended, only 10 people, but 9 out of the 10 were cured. So you could make the case that this resistance-associated substitution, we should look for this. But it's important to understand what that means. If we're going to look for this, we now have to genotype everybody, and then for people with genotype 3, we now have to look for this resistance-associated substitution. So let's just walk through that. If you look in Western countries, genotype 3 is about 20% of infections. This mutation occurs in 5 to 10% of those with genotype 3. So about 2% of people will have this mutation, so out of 1,000 patients, around 10 to 20 will have genotype 3 with this mutation, and you can see that, let's just assume those numbers hold, and the cure rate drops to 75%. So out of your 1,000 patients, you now, if you take the people, you assume that it's 99% if you follow through with the treatment. And for the non-genotype 3 patients, it'll be, 99% for those without the mutation and 75% for those with it, and 99% for the other genotype. So overall, your number of people with an SVR without genotyping out of your 1,000 will be somewhere between 985 to 988. And if you genotype all 1,000 people to achieve 99% overall SVR rates, you get to 990 cures. So basically, genotyping and doing this resistance testing leads to 2 to 5 additional SVRs per 1,000 patients. So is it worth it? Well, no, unless potentially you're one of these 2 to 5 people. And this is sort of the would you do it if it was your mother approach that I like to think about this. How would you treat your mother differently than you would treat other patients? And I do think the only reason I'm highlighting this, I'm definitely not suggesting we do this test, just to be clear. But what I do want to highlight is that simplification does potentially come at some small cost for individuals. And I think as clinicians, that can sometimes be very challenging because we're looking at an individual person and we're saying, is this actually the best thing for that person, or is this the best public health approach? And I think overall the public health approach outweighs the benefit for the individual, but I don't think we should completely forget about this fact that for individuals, when we simplify, we may actually have some minor consequences. But if we look at this overall, simplification will definitely increase diagnosis rates, it will increase treatment uptake, and eventually it's going to reduce disease burden at the population level, even if it's not optimal for every individual patient. So that's why we need it. What do we mean by this? Well, when we think about simplification, it's important to think about it through really the whole cascade of care, and it's important to remember that the cascade of care doesn't begin with the people living with the infection, but it includes those people at risk for the infection. We sometimes forget about that, and you'll see that our first session actually is focused on simplification on the prevention side. I'm not going to talk much about it because it's going to follow with the talks immediately after, and it's important that we also continue to follow people with Hep C after they're cured or for hepatitis B when they have either controlled or inactive disease. But we really need to think about simplification at every step. So ideally for diagnosis, we should have a single test. It ideally should be point of care. We should be able to stage liver disease non-invasively, ideally immediately, and it needs to have broad access. Treatment needs to be minimal or no pre-treatment workup, clear indications and simple regimens, no on-treatment monitoring, and a finite duration with a clear outcome. And then prevention, obviously it would be great to have a vaccine, and harm reduction is key. So let's look for hepatitis B and C, where we're at with these. Well, we can make the case that the diagnosis is relatively simple, but it's not it's still not probably simple enough. Staging disease, we do have non-invasive tools, but they're either not immediate, or if they are immediate, they're not broadly available. When we look at treatment, hepatitis B really struggles here, where we really can't get away with no pre-treatment workup, and we don't have clear indications for when to treat people, and that's really a challenge. And we definitely don't, at least with our current therapies, have finite duration or clear outcomes. And then on the prevention side for hepatitis C, obviously a vaccine is missing, and harm reduction, although it's being increasingly used, is not broadly enough implemented throughout the world. And I think it is important to think about these two infections and recognize some of the key differences. Is that the transmission for hepatitis B is still globally, vertical transmission is still the major driver, but of course we do have a vaccine. With hepatitis C, it's really a problem throughout life, and it's still globally iatrogenic transmission and through injection drug use. The epidemiology, there's definitely some overlap, but there are some key differences about where the major burden is. Unfortunately, sub-Saharan Africa has a relatively high burden of both infections, as do parts of Asia, but there are differences with the epidemiology. The diagnosis is complicated for hepatitis B because the serology is not simple and it requires multiple tests, whereas for hepatitis C, it's pretty simple, although still usually requires two tests in most scenarios. The natural history for B is much more dynamic and unpredictable, and this makes it more challenging to simplify, whereas hep C is slowly progressive, and treatment decisions are much more complicated for B because long-term or indefinite care is required, which means that hepatitis B treatment is primarily in specialty care, whereas hepatitis C is simple, finite, curative treatment and is more and more moving to primary care and really should become primarily there. And just looking a little bit more at treatment, if you look at hep C here, highlighting the challenges really in red, and you can see that hep C is really just about access. That's really the only remaining challenge, because we have a pretty simple diagnosis. Everyone needs treatment if they're infected. The treatment is nearly 100% effective. You need little or no monitoring, and that there's no risk of any complications if you don't have cirrhosis after you're cured. So that's very good. But with hepatitis B, it's really a much more complicated scenario. We have complicated serology. Determining if and when to start treatment is not straightforward, and if and when to stop therapy is even more complicated. We definitely need long-term monitoring. We need long-term coverage. If someone starts on therapy, we want to make sure that they can continue it and it doesn't get interrupted. And then liver cancer surveillance is required even for those small number of people who clear the infection. So the only good thing about hepatitis B is that the drugs are relatively simple to use, and fortunately now they're generic. But that is, you can see that in terms of the treatment, these two infections are quite different in terms of the ability to simplify. So with hepatitis C, I think the diagnostic challenge really is that most places are still using the standard approach of antibody followed by PCR. And when you look at all the steps that are involved to get a simple antibody test done and then a PCR done, you can see that there's lots of places for people to get lost to follow up and fall out of this relatively simple diagnostic cascade that already is straightforward. So now what we should be doing is we now have the tools to make this very simple, where we can do a simple point of care test, we can do a follow that by a point of care RNA, you can exclude cirrhosis at the bedside with transient elastography, and ideally someone could get their full diagnosis and workup in less than 2 hours and get them on treatment started the same day. Now, unfortunately, this doesn't happen almost anywhere with the exception of small demonstration projects to show it can be done. So the challenge here is not that we don't have the tools, it's that we don't have the access. So some simple things that we can think about are using the tools that we have and trying to make them more useful than they were. And this is just some work that we've done, but this is just to give an example of this, where we have looked at using one of the point of care antibody tests, the OraQuick test, and what we were interested to see is whether antibody titers, which tend to wane over time after someone's cleared the infection, we thought they might be higher in people with active viremia, and sure enough, that was true. So you can see that the time to this test becoming positive has gone, which in the label says you should read it at 20 to 40 minutes. We actually found that of viremic patients, they're all positive within 5 minutes. And we've now tested, you can see 227 viremic patients were positive at 5 minutes, 113 non-viremic positive patients were positive in that time frame, but nobody with viremia was negative at 5 minutes. So this would allow basically taking a test that's already approved and just making it simpler by allowing us to do a read time at 5 minutes. If someone's negative at that point, they may have antibodies, but they don't have virus, and so it just speeds up the process. Now, hep C treatment has also gotten much simpler. I was amazed to see that the ASLD IDSA guidelines, which the update was just released last week, have gone from this massive document down to a single page. So this is good news. So this is what's really laid out, where you're ruling out cirrhosis, you do a drug interaction check, some minimal pre-treatment labs, you put someone on a pangenotypic regimen, so you'll see genotyping removed from the ASLD guidelines for the first time. No on-treatment monitoring required. Do an SVR12 HCV RNA, and then follow up if risk for reinfection. Now, this is only for people without cirrhosis, but I think this is important to show that even the slow and conservative hepatology societies are slowly coming on board to recognize that we can really simplify things. It really can't get much simpler than that. And because of that, we can really move it into primary care. This is the ASCEND trial, which many of you would have seen, of doing treatment by nurse practitioners or primary care physicians and showing that the outcomes were similar to specialists. But actually, the reason I'm showing this is not about the outcomes. It's about the fact that the primary care providers without a lot of experience in Hep C were trained to treat this infection in a 3-hour session and did just as well as specialists. So this really highlights that this is actually at the point where it can't get much simpler, and we just need to do it more effectively. Hepatitis B is much more complicated. This is to show you the natural history and where you might treat people in this natural history. But the key point is that not everybody needs treatment, and so you really need to be following people lifelong, and you've got this period where once you start treatment, because it's either long-term or indefinite, it's a much more complicated scenario. And when you look at the guidelines, you can see I've shown you here the ASLD, EASL, and APASL guidelines, and I could throw in the WHO guidelines, and you can see that they all use different criteria for when people need to go on treatment. And this makes it very challenging, especially if some of these tests are not widely available. So it begs the question, should we simplify this and forget about the whole workup and just treat everybody? There is some push to treat everybody who's surface antigen positive, particularly in low and middle income countries where diagnostics may be more costly than treatment, and follow-up is often difficult. And the rationale here would be that generic drugs are likely more cost-effective than using, with the generic drugs, this is likely more cost-effective than the current guidelines. And because the drugs are safe and resistance is rarely a problem, you can see that this is probably a good idea, but it's actually very hard to generate the evidence for this because it's hard to show in a cohort that treating everybody will be helpful. You need a lot of people, a lot of follow-up, and to really demonstrate that this is going to work is not a simple task. And in truth, we might actually need to look at what happens when you do an experiment at the population level, and there is an effort to consider doing this in Uzbekistan with their elimination project. And this just gives an idea that perhaps, again, using simplification will actually generate the data to show whether or not it's always the best approach. So to summarize, simplification I think will be critical to reach the WHO elimination goals. The tools to simplify are largely available, but I would highlight that they're much more available for hepatitis C than for hepatitis B, at least right now. We really need to think about simplification across the full continuum of care, so from prevention through diagnosis and treatment. And we'll be discussing both successful and I hope some unsuccessful approaches because, as we mentioned, these are important for learnings over the next today and tomorrow. So I'll finish with that, and we're going to, I think, save questions till the end of the session. So thank you very much.